Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this countdown to the end of the season by one of the new faces in Scottish professional wrestling. I am joined by the leader of the Daisy Chain, hashtag Daisy Chain. It's Daisy Jenkins. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
I'm very excited for this one just because I like a good pun. And as soon as I saw hashtag Daisy Chain, I was like, yes, that is perfect. I'm all in. It's just
good stuff.
It's a nice, easy thing. I'm a very simple man, very simple tastes. And if you give me a pun, I'm all in for wrestling.
I'm the same.
So first question is always the same. It's the cliche question that we ask wrestlers. It's just how you got into pro wrestling. So how did you get hooked on pro wrestling? What was the first memory? What were you watching that got you into it?
So it's probably a cliche answer, but I had two older brothers who watched it all the time. My mum and dad were not so keen on me watching it, so I used to watch it through the living room door. We had like a glass panel door, and I used to watch it through there, try and see if I could sit and watch it. And if we ever had to kind of like stay over a like friend's house or something like that, and they'd be watching, I would watch it then. And then eventually just got to the point where I think my mum and dad were like, okay, she's going to watch it anyway, so we'll just let her, kind of thing. But my earliest memories, and I was trying to look up exactly when it was, so it's like 97, 98, so it would have been like 7 or 8. But my earliest memories were Kane's debut, so obviously like that's got to be Kane, and Mankind getting thrown off Hell in a Cell.
Right, so yeah, 98. 97 and 98.
Kind of around that time would have been when I kind of first got hooked on it. And I think like at that time it was just everybody talked about it at school, didn't they? So if you didn't watch it and you didn't know what was going on, you were kind of left out. So that was the first time that I got into wrestling. I kind of fell out of it a little bit kind of coming up, because that would have been like 7, 8, so maybe when I was like 10, 11. And I started watching it again in 2018 when the first all-women's Royal Rumble.
Okay. I am shocked. I honestly thought, because I was speaking to a lot of these FPWA guys and they're all, I was expecting you to come up with something like really recent and I was going to feel really old about it.
No.
I'm very shocked to find out we're about the same age.
I have
had a hard paper round in comparison in this episode, unfortunately. So we got in round about the same time, because I've said it in many episodes. My first memory was Kane at Undertaker Inferno match on Raw.
Oh, fab. Yeah.
And being 8 or 9, probably not the best one to go with, as I was terrified of Kane for a very long time afterwards.
I don't know why I loved him so much, because I was terrified, but I think it was just, the characters were just so good at that point, you could not watch it.
You say your parents or your mum weren't that keen on you watching it. I suppose it's not, especially actually at a peak, 98, 99, it was unfortunately a boys thing to watch, because it was all violence and all that kind of stuff. But I'm surprised that you had people at school that would speak about it. I think for me, I had one person. I had my best friend, Craig. And maybe, best friend Craig. He was the only other person who watched wrestling when I went to school. The rest of them just made fun, or they were closeted fans, because there'd always be one that would go. There's always one that would go, oh, I've got a bunch of wrestling figures. You want to come over to mine at the weekend and we'll play with the figures? And I'm like, you've never spoken about wrestling until now. So how has this happened? And you've got like a cool Kevin Nash figure with the tassels and everything. You've clearly got your parents to get you some like, cool ones.
You definitely know what's going on.
Yeah, absolutely. So you say you took your break from watching wrestling. You came back in 2018 for the Women's Royal Rumble. Were you keeping tabs on it? Was there anything, or was it just you find out there's a Women's Royal Rumble and you're like, I need to watch that?
Yeah, well, to be honest, like I think my brother started watching it again, maybe like a few years before that. And he went to a couple of shows and I was like, what are you doing? Why wrestling was when we were kids? And then, you know, obviously, like, look at me now. But I think it was interesting to me that there was, you know, that it was the first ever Women's Royal Rumble. And for it being kind of so late, it was, you know, it's 2018, it just kind of seemed as though like it was a big moment. And I think Ronda Rousey came out at the end of that, and I'd kind of watched UFC a little bit. So I knew who she was. So I was just interested in it. at that point. And then I think it just grew from there. It was like a rabbit hole I went down, like crazy rabbit hole. And then, you know, from then on, it was just complete obsession.
So like filling in the blanks as you went from that
100%. Point. 100%. Yeah, it took me a long time to catch up.
So it's 2018, the network's always is there. So for £10, if you want to dedicate yourself a month out of your way, you could probably catch up on most of the big talking points in that time. As a UFC fan, was Lesnar another one that you'd watch as well?
Yeah, I kind of seen that he'd been in and out of it as well, and it was quite interesting seeing like how he was in the two different, you know, categories. But it was the two of them that kind of brought me into it, and then, you know, obviously, like, the more that I watched, the more I kind of got to know other people. But that was sort of like the inlet, especially for like watching the women's wrestling, for sure.
And if you had a couple of minutes of your day, you could watch all of CM Punk's fights as well. unnecessary slam on CM Punk there. He's clearly making more money than I am, so I shouldn't really.
Yeah. He's doing all right.
Yeah, he's doing fine. He can have his opinions on Twitter and whatnot, but you know, still making more than I am. So you had your break. So your favorites then? You mentioned like sort of Rousey coming back in to it, and you mentioned Kane as well being a curiosity favorite, as in like you liked him but you were afraid of him. Was there anyone else in your first and or second runs that have properly you're enamored by, you really enjoy watching?
Yeah, so my favorite when I was a kid was Edge was my favorite, for loads of different reasons, but I think everybody else that I knew were more Hardy Boys, and I was Edge and Christian. obviously like Lita and Trish, China at that time. I was always a big fan of Triple H, Kane always, back in the day. And then kind of come around to it now, like Ronda Rousey was the one who kind of got me into it, but it was actually, I didn't properly start watching it until I seen Becky Lynch's heel promo the first time that she tried to go heel, and it didn't quite work, you know, kind of the starting of the man, and it was really Becky Lynch that got me super obsessed by it. I just, everything about her.
I suppose back when we started watching, the only British person you'd see would be Bulldog, and he was humongous. He was unattainable as someone who you could see. But I know Becky Lynch isn't British, and that's a whole other kind of worms, but to see someone who's like this side of the Atlantic being so like loved by the fans, even though she's trying to get them to boo them, to boo her, must be that was that early inspiration, thinking, well, if she can do it, there's probably a chance that I could give it a go.
Yeah, I think the more that I watched, the more I kind of thought that I could potentially do it, or at least give it a try. Like, I loved it that much that I at least wanted to give it a go. But I think it was just everything. I think at that time as well, like, it was so fueled with emotion, you know, like coming up to like the kind of betrayal of her and Charlotte, and that kind of story, and then her rise kind of like, you know, going towards WrestleMania, and just everything to do with that. It was just such a good time to get back into it, because there was just so much going on in terms of that storyline, and it gave you something to kind of root for. And I think like at that point, I needed something to root for. So she was a huge inspiration for me, not just to get into wrestling, but just in terms of like life in general. And then again, like the more I watched, the more I wanted to do it.
So definitely, when WWE get it right, when it comes to that kind of emotional stuff, they just always smash out the park. I mean, sometimes other people could be watching the same thing like I am or you are, and they might think it's not working, but there'll be someone there that's in the crowd going, this is the best thing ever. This is
100%.
They're watching Omos and Lashley, and they're going, this is the best thing I've ever seen in my life. And we're watching going, this is a bit naff, but you know, it's working for someone. I think arm wrestling, I absolute non sequitur from that, but arm wrestling videos in WWE apparently get the highest views.
Oh, really?
So I don't know how, I don't know why. I don't think I want to know why at this point, but it's just one of those things. So whenever you see two beefy men doing the arm wrestling, it's usually going to get a really big number on YouTube. There's a fun fact for people that are listening, for educating, not only on Daisy Jenkins, but also just in general.
In arm wrestling.
in arm wrestling. Wouldn't do it myself. I'm very weak, even though I'm a big guy. So we said your brother went to shows. Was it just local shows? Was it Scottish, like ICW, or was it the WWE shows at like the Brayhead and what have you?
Yeah, it was WWE shows. I actually only went to a few. I went to one in Newcastle, just one of the live events. And then I went to one at the Hydro, and then ended up going to see Raw in Baltimore in 2019. So that was pretty cool. But those were really the only ones I got. I didn't really know the Scottish scene or the UK scene at all until I kind of got into it. So I'd never really been to any indie shows before that.
Baltimore is a bit of a way to go to see the wrestling. Was that just a coincidence you were there and there's wrestling?
Yeah,
on?
I mean, I used to live there, kind of. I worked at a summer camp in between Baltimore and DC about 10 years ago, 10, 12 years ago. And I still have friends, so we were over visiting. And I dragged them all to go, go to Raw because it was in Baltimore at the same time. Just one of those things where, you know, for it to be in the place that you were in, mm-hmm. at the time that you're in, it's just one of those things where it's like, what were the, because obviously 2019, it was when I was on the road the full time. It was just one of those coincidences that I couldn't really pass up, but it was brilliant.
Oh yeah. So if you have that, it's like, that's just destiny. You have to go to
see
it.
You absolutely have to go. And it was the week before Bailey turned heel and she cut the, what did she call them? The
Bailey Buddies.
Yeah. So it was the week before that, so like that was really cool because there was, again, it was like an emotionally fueled episode because there was a lot about to happen, so it was a really cool one to go through.
Another big moment probably in just women's wrestling history, wrestling history in general, but Bayley being such a huge fan favourite, dubbed like the female John Cena just because she was mm-hmm. so beloved, to then do that.
It was brilliant. She is unbelievable.
I know. I can't wait till she comes back. I think it's sorely needed for. I mean, there's some spots open now for different reasons, but
yeah.
I don't want to age this podcast terribly, even though it's only going out.
We don't know
in about 10 days. God, just imagine next 10 days what comes out. We're just joking about it. So you weren't aware of the Scottish scene until you got into it. So how did you find out about, or was it FPWA you started with, or did you try another school? It was FPWA.
No.
How did you find out about FPWA?
So I think probably for like the whole of 2019, I was kind of trying to find a way of getting into it or at least giving it a go. So I worked in Glasgow. So I was kind of looking at schools there and trying to figure it out. But at the time I worked in retail. So, and I was a manager in retail. So there wasn't really a lot of time for me to do anything else. So it was kind of frustrating because I kind of knew that it was something that I really wanted to do and obviously something that I wanted to do for myself, but I wouldn't have been able to do it at that time because I had no free time at all. So it just kind of didn't really work out, but I needed to change jobs anyway because that was kind of running the end of its course. But getting into wrestling was another reason why I wanted to change jobs and try and, you know, go for Monday to Friday type thing and have the weekends free so that if, you know, I did give it a go, that I could actually give it a go and not always have to kind of be fighting with work type thing. And I managed to get a new job just at the start of 2020. And then obviously like COVID was three months later. So I was originally working in Bristol. I was supposed to be down there for like 6 months training. And then I was going to come back. And I'd kind of been following FPW because they'd only just really opened at that point. And my office is in Fife, so I kind of thought, okay, well, if I've got to go to the office, like, at least I could go there and then potentially go to the school afterwards, because it's kind of like halfway, my office would be halfway between here and there. And it kind of looked as though they were, you know, brand new, and they maybe had some things going on with their memberships, and the membership seems to, like, suit me, so I kind of was looking at that. But then, obviously, COVID shut everything down, and we were all from home. And then I think it must have been like July, they randomly just put up a post saying, you know, they were kind of opening up for new beginners. And I just emailed straight away, sent the money, didn't even ask any questions. I just sent the deposit. And then I had to wait until the October when we came out of lockdown and gyms were allowed to open again. I had to wait until then to actually start. But even then it was non-contact. So it was a really weird time to start.
But again, it works into this kind of through line that we may have during all this chat is it seems like it was destined for you to join FPWA because that's where your 100%. Office was. And it was just like, of course, when you see it's open, it's, of course it's open. I've just moved. I'm going there regularly. Of course, a wrestling school is open in the same place.
Yeah.
And it's just one of those things. So from when you find out about FPWA then, like I say, you weren't aware too much of a scene in this country.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, you probably weren't aware of Andy Wilde or too much about Andy Wilde outside of maybe the name.
I looked him up when I saw FPWA and I looked up who the coach was. That was about it.
So with that break between you finding it and then putting your money towards it or at least thinking you're going to do it, were you just all in YouTube binging everything you could? Or
kind of, yeah, I mean, like not so much before I kind of signed up for it, but certainly in between the time that I signed up and then between going for my first sort of training session and stuff, and then I think I only managed 4 sessions. And it was, you know, learning how to roll, bump, that kind of thing. And then we were locked down again. So then I got the benefit of doing all of the Zoom seminars that they put on. So I joined at that point. So I think I got a lot of information from that and I was able to kind of direct what I was going to look at and the kind of, you know, places that there were. And I kind of went on a YouTube binge then, kind of just seeing who everybody was and finding out what the scene was, which was quite an interesting time, to be fair.
It was I'm just realizing when you would have came in to do that. Yeah, it was a very, very interesting time to do all that. I do have questions about that, so I'm going to get them in because I usually ask them anyway, but they've asked them, so I'll get them asked. Dudes at Ringside Podcast, great guys there. I think they've been trying to tap you for an interview as well, which.
So, yeah, it's the time difference.
I know. I did a show with them and it was trying to figure out time differences.
It's really difficult.
They just asked who trained you. So FPWA, I know Andy Wilde's there. I know a couple of other trainers. Was it Andy that took that first 4 sessions or was it?
Yeah.
It was Andy himself. Cool. So did you have any of it? I don't know. Is Jason, I think he helps.
Yeah.
Stu, of course, he's talking about as well. So was it just a bit of everyone?
It was mostly Andy, because I'd done the 4 sessions and it was Andy that had done all of those, and then we'd done the seminar, so that was kind of everybody. And then when we came back, it was still non-contact, so again that was mostly Andy. But then we started contact kind of last July, but I mean it's crazy to say that I didn't lock up until last July. It was Andy, and then when he went away to NXT, I met Johnny Lyons. And he's kind of taken me under his wing a little bit. So,
I love Johnny Lyons. That's not a surprise to anyone who will be listening to this. He's such a fantastically intense guy who will just do anything for you if you ask. As long as you don't do it at cinema. That's probably the one rule.
Yeah, you don't know how funny that is because it is hilarious.
I've heard so many stories of Johnny Lyons' cinema experience, mostly from him.
Yeah, so I mean,
he's not shy about it.
There's rules,
I know. Last time I usually go for the Marvel films because I'm, as you may be able to tell from the background here, I like the Marvel films, and every time I see someone put their phone on, like it's like, oh, Moonface. Bloody moon facing all over the place, and it's just because that's what Coach Stews, he rants and reviews, that's what he says on all the time.
I love it so much. He fills my life with such joy.
I know that. So he's taken you under his wing when the internet died. That's where we find out. So is he just giving you, because Johnny's got all this like timing and this so many little things that I forgot about until I saw him wrestle again, like at this point a week ago.
How was it good?
It was amazing. I didn't realize how much I missed Johnny Lyons until he came out, and I was like, oh my god, wrestling has missed him so much. He grew a beard, he looks amazing, he looks more ripped than he did when I last saw him, and that's
he's been working so hard, he's unreal.
So what was like having Johnny then as someone who maybe not have known his career until you did that YouTube binge in between, what was it like going into and seeing Andy Wilde and Johnny Lyons and everyone else? Was it just a overwhelming first experience, or how did you find it?
It was quite overwhelming because I think because of the time that I started as well, so I was new, everybody kind of seen my face on Zoom when we were doing the seminars, but nobody had met me in person really, because I'd only met maybe two or three people by that point. So I'd been part of it, you know, part of the FPWA students for about like 6 months before I really met anyone. So it was quite overwhelming. And then obviously like kind of coming into it with not doing any contact at all and just doing all the kind of non-contact stuff until restrictions lifted, and then all of a sudden being in the ring with people, the whole experience, yeah, I think from the beginning it's been quite overwhelming, but everybody's been amazing, so it was very easy as well to kind of become part of it.
How did you find that non-contact and doing the online stuff? I know some people are more like, I don't know, more studious based, where they'll just learn everything and then do it. Or like myself, I'm more of a doer. You can tell me all the practicalities of it, but unless I'm doing it, I will not understand how that works. So how did you find going from that to were you able to get everything kind of worked in your brain before doing the actual contact stuff? Or are you more of a doer than a reader?
I'm probably a mix of both, to be honest. Like, I think I took the opportunity because it was the only opportunity that I had at that time. I had to make most of it, so I had to learn as much as I possibly could in that time of being in lockdown as well. But I was also kind of it was all new to me, so I think I didn't really ask that many questions because I didn't really know what kind of questions to ask, but I had the benefit of everybody else's experience and everybody else who'd been doing it for a few years and kind of gained a lot from the questions that they were asking. So I think like I've maybe like just had the benefit of their experience from that point of view. So it's just all the things that I didn't know I needed to know. And I think even, you know, if they didn't happen at this point, I would maybe still be struggling with some parts of that because I mean, I've had the experience of going through those seminars. And I think like the people that we got on for them as well, like obviously like some huge people, and like to be sitting on a call with them, like, you know, a couple of months in and not even really done anything was a bit, again, like you say, overwhelming. But I learned so much from that. And I was able to put it into practice. Like, and it's, I think the more that time goes on, the more I realized I did learn during that time. And I think more now, so like going into shows and stuff like that, like there was a lot of things that were spoken about in terms of that. So definitely coming in handy.
It's one of those weird things. I mean, I didn't do any of that, of course, because I'm a podcast, a parent podcaster, so I'm not wrestling, so I don't need to know these things. But I jumped into a Looking Sharp one when he did a tag team seminar. Krieger did it. It was a free one. So I was like, oh, no harm, no foul. We'll jump in and see what it's like. And it's you don't realize how much theory and actual logic and practice goes into all these matches being built. And I suppose when you're coming in, your only experience then is just watching it and enjoying it, the entertainment aspect of it. And then when you go in and they go, right, tag team matches, the guy has to hold a rope. They cut off the ring. In order to cut off the ring, they need to have the... You're looking at it going, I never realized any of this. And then the next tag match you watch and you go, ah.
That's what you did there. Yeah.
They're doing all the things I've just listened about and it's working. It's a very interesting art form is wrestling. It's
100%, yeah.
And everyone takes something different away from it, whether it is just purely entertainment or they like the technical intricacies and the subtleties and all that kind of stuff. It's just it's a very interesting thing. Do you have a question about your training? I've realized that even though I've screenshot you sent me questions that you got through Instagram. If I try and do it through my computer, it comes up really tiny.
Yeah,
so I'm looking down at my phone. I'm not being rude. I'm looking down to read them.
No, you're good.
So we've got quite a few in. Let's see. Who trained you? I've already asked that one. We've got. God, I can't read that. Mike D. I know I've got glasses on. I can't really read these things. Right. So Ricky Mack 83. He asked, "How did you get into wrestling?" We've ticked that one off. That's good. Mike DAFC asked, how long have you been training to be a wrestler? So you kind of mentioned you did non-contact. Was it October
2020? October 2020. Four sessions. So that took us to December. And then we came back in May. 2021, and I didn't start contact until July 2021.
So that's a lot of stop-start in between, and the Zoom seminars can do really wondrous things for mentally things, but how did you keep yourself active? Were you, going to the gym? Lockdown, that can't happen. How are you keeping yourself active? Do you have quite a sporty background anyway? The stuff you did to keep yourself fit?
I did have a sporty background. When I came into wrestling, so that October, I was not in shape at all. And I realised, even though it was just doing rolls and, like, you know, warm-ups, I mean, it was quite, like, they were quite long sessions for there only being, like, two people, so you would do quite a lot. I knew instantly that I wasn't in the shape that I needed to be. So in that second lockdown between whatever it was, December and April, I lost 2 stone. I got in the best shape that I've ever been in, because I knew that when I came back, I wasn't going to get very far if I didn't put the effort in then. So I kind of worked every day, mostly doing like CrossFit based workouts, because it's easy in the house to do that kind of thing, because you don't need a lot of equipment, and it's mostly body weight. So that's what I've done in between that time to get into shape. And I've just built on it ever since. But it's one of those things where I just knew that I wouldn't have lasted very long if I went into it in the state that I was in, because it was too difficult. You know, like, I was coming home and it would take me 2 weeks. We had 2 weeks in between those like sessions, and it would take me those 2 weeks to recover. So I was like, I can't, you know, I'm a little bit older, I can't be doing that. So I put the effort in that.
Well, I mean, that's great, something to work towards, because if you lost two stone, I probably found it during that period, because
we all did.
Nothing
we
to all do, did. Nothing to do, and nothing to work towards at the same time. Yeah. I mean, my only thing I was doing was this, and you don't see me from like the man breasts up, so you don't see anything below most of the time. So I could be as fat as I want, which is probably not the best thing to go through. But you know, it's just how life has dealt me the cruel hand of mother's genes. She never listens to this, so thankfully I can it'll be fine, because I realize that's probably a really mean thing to say out loud. Right.
Wait,
so the showcase was supposed to take place probably just after you started then, so that probably was never a thing that you were going to be on. No. But when you found out that there was a possibility December 2021 that there was going to be they were going to do a couple of showcase shows in front of friends, family, select guests, was that your next goal, or did you think you were actually going to get onto that show at all, since you only had kind of stop start training at that point?
Yeah, I mean, I think like I'd worked really hard to that point. I think like, even though like I just started in July, you know, I started with doing like one session a week, and then I started having 2 sessions a week, then I started going 3, and then I started helping out with the kids as well, so I was going 4 days a week. And I was kind of at that point where I felt like I was ready to kind of give it that first go. I struggled a lot with confidence as well. So at that time it was, and I think at that time I probably was struggling a lot with confidence, just kind of like committing to it. Like I was picking things up and I was doing all right, but I just couldn't connect everything together. Like it wasn't clicking. So it was a good thing to look forward to say, well, you know, if you get put on this, then yeah, you'll need to find some way of making it click, because otherwise you'll freeze, which I was terrified of. But it was something, I think, like I wrote down goals at the start of 2021, and it was to have a training match, a 5-minute training match was like my goal for the end of the year. And I got to do that multiple times, so that was a tick in the right box. But the showcase was a wonderful first experience in front of a crowd, with having like some of my friends and family there, and being in with the girls that I trained with. It was just, it was a special moment, and I think it was special for everybody.
Of course, you see a lot of rest, especially the first couple of matches. Yeah, they can do the moves are ace. But yeah, it's that finesse in between that kind of just makes a match itself. So how did you discover Daisy Jenkins? How did you find the way to get that finesse in between the moves?
I don't know. She's just, she's just evolved. I think it is finding that confidence. And I've taken a lot of inspiration from a few people, kind of going back to, I mean, I think if people look on my Instagram and stuff, they see I've kind of got like a bit of an 80s, 90s aesthetic. It's very much influenced by what I like to watch, you know, like 80s movies, that kind of thing. And going back to 80s women's wrestling was something that really kind of inspired me to kind of come to the point where it's like, okay, well, what kind of wrestler do you want to be? And I, again, I went down a rabbit hole and I just got so inspired by all of those women that that's kind of where Daisy's come from. And my niece as well is a huge inspiration for it.
I was noticing you did put your gear up. You said it was like Sherry Martel inspired. So when I'm thinking 80s then, a bit of glow probably in there
100%.
As well. So, I mean, because nowadays, I mean, I suppose when I started watching Scottish wrestling anyway, there was like 5-6 women's wrestlers. And that was about it. There was like your Viper, Bette Noir, and Carmel, Sarah, Kayla Ray.
Mm-hmm.
That was it, I think. And then Emerson Jane started. Oh, Nikki Storm. How could I forget Nikki? terrible. And then and Emerson Jane started just about the same year as I started watching. So there was not that much different in characters because one wasn't enough women to have that difference. And nowadays you've got like Ashley Vega, who's the diva, and you've got Molly Spartan, who's the big bruiser. We've got a vegan in Ellie Armstrong, plant-based powerhouse. And then there's not anyone like yourself. I mean, the only person who came close was maybe a Leah Owens. She did like an 80s throwback kind of thing. So it's great that nowadays that there's so many women wrestling that they can have all these different characters and it all seems to just work. But I really like that promo with the whole like 90s VHS vibe and the Walkman.
Yeah, I'm glad.
All that kind of thing. I had a CD Walkman. And it was it was the worst thing ever because I did a paper round at the same time, and every time I walked, the CD skipped off the top of the off the newspapers. And to be honest, nowadays when I listen to the same songs, it used to be Blink-182. I'd have that album on quite a lot, and just their great sets. Wasn't any particular one, but even I will listen to the songs. I listen to them. My brain puts the skips in them.
Yeah,
it's awful. Every time I listen to go, well, that version's wrong on Spotify, the official version they've handed over, that's wrong. There's a skip in the middle of it there. I like that. It's also kind of a bit, I don't know if you're big into the Marvel, but very Guardians of the Galaxy, it seems to be a quite hot thing at the moment as well.
I'm glad it's translating.
I'm probably apparently the same age, which I'm still not believing, I'm probably the perfect audience for that particular promo anyway, because it's all stuff that I grew up with anyway. So Sherry Martel then, for the attire itself. So 80s women's wrestling, you mentioned Sherry, was there anyone else in particular? I'm trying to think of others around about that time. You're jumping Bomb Angels, all that kind of stuff.
They're incredible. Rockin' Robin, Magnificent Mimi, Leilani Kai. There was also the Irish lady, Violet something. Is it Violet something? But they just had the best matches.
I'll find it. Irish women wrestler Velvet McIntyre.
Velvet McIntyre. That's it.
There we go.
And they were just like, I think they were just super technical. And, you know, there was nothing too fancy. It was just really technical and the sort of the basics, but done really well. And then it was just the characters. Like, it's just so enamoring to watch. And I think in terms of what I would want to bring to it, that's the kind of thing that I would want to try and replicate.
It was very weird because the 80s, like you're saying, it was very technical based. And then we got into the late 90s and it was not technical based at all. There was
were very technical, they just didn't get the chance.
But a lot of the time it was just rolling in cat fights, and then obviously went through the early 2000s, bit of a balance, so on the cat fight side of things. And then we got like your Melinas and all that kind of stuff, Mickey James and Trish Stratus. And then now we're into a stage where they're just, it's just wrestlers. There's no, there shouldn't be, there, I don't think there is a definition now. It's just they're wrestlers and that's it. Yep. Full stop. So it's a very interesting time. If you've binged and went back to the '80s to now, you've seen that kind of dips and peaks and troughs of women's wrestling in general and how far it's come, because it's certainly come a long way since then.
100%.
And all for the better, I think, generally. I can't think of any bad points that now it's main event WrestleMania, main event pay-per-views and it doesn't feel forced or out of place. No. It's just like, of course, it's the hottest storyline going. Of course, Bianca Belair and Sasha Banks are going to be the main event. Just makes sense.
Yep.
So it's a nice time to be watching wrestling. I mean, as long as you're off Twitter.
I agree. I can't get on board with it.
That's the weirdest thing. I think maybe the only guest, only second guest so far I haven't contacted through Twitter. It's been through Instagram.
For sure.
And it's because it's like, it's best just to stay off it. Twitter's a horrible place for wrestling. All the opinions, none of the thought. Right, let's see if we've got any more questions about starting up before we dive into your matches itself. That's all dream stuff, so we'll leave that. Oh, that's the dudes again. This is great professionalism that I've got going on here. Right, okay, we've got Tom Humphreys, or Tom Atlas, as he's also known as. What's your favourite part of training?
Oh, that's a good point. I can't say everything, can I?
But it's going to be a big list.
Yeah. we do a creative part quite a lot. So we go through, obviously, like our warm-up and our drills, and then there'll be some sort of learning aspect, so whether that be like a sequence or, you know, something that we can put into practice. And then we get given kind of like 5-10 minutes to come up with like a 2-minute thing, and we can pair off with whoever we want. And I think it used to terrify me when I first started. It terrified the life out of me, and I would overthink every single thing that I'd done, not realizing that, you know, I'd only just started, only been in the door like 2 months or something like that. Like, it's not going to be perfect. But I would just, it absolutely terrified me. But now it's the thing that I look forward to, because it does give me that opportunity to try and put everything together. And really, now that I kind of feel like I know who Daisy is and like I know who I am becoming, it's that time that gives me that opportunity to kind of show, one, that I've learned what we've been going over, but also to kind of put it into practice and making it my own, and maybe what I could use in matches in the future, but also getting to work with everybody else, and not having, you know, not always working with the same person, kind of like switching up. So that's been really good recently. I've enjoyed that.
Excellent. Right, so let's dive in then. So FPWA Showcase, your first match in front of a crowd, 14th of December, 2021. It was Triple Threat, Harmony Sky, and Beth Shorty. Unfortunately didn't pick up the win, but that's quite a big thing to go into for your first match, because usually it's either one-on-one, most times a rumble, or a tag team. So at least there's other bodies there to support you. Even though a Triple Threat, you are all supporting each other, but it's very much a intriguing dynamic to go into for your first match. So how did you feel it went?
I thought it went amazing. I loved every minute of it. And we wrestled every day of the showcase. It was like, I think it was Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday that we did. So it was amazing just getting to do that and in front of different people, because it was obviously a different crowd each night. But I think in terms of the three of us, we've got very clear differences in who we are. So it was a really good story to tell. And I think that's what made it so good. And being at that point, the only three women that we had at FPWA, it was quite special.
Yeah, of course. Good. Yeah, I've got the 14th and 16th. So I think middle one was that a wee wrestlers kind of one, which had a couple other matches. Yeah, that's what I thought. Otherwise, my source for the results is getting getting a talking to, who asked never to be revealed. So there we go. I think if people read them, who's there and who's in the know, we'll know who gave me the results for the shows. So you had three goes at this then. So did you find that the first match being you were a bit nervy for it, and then by the time that Thursday rolled around, you're like, well, this is easier. This is going to be a piece of cake.
Kind of how it was. Yeah. And my family were at the Tuesday one. So it was terrifying.
A little less pressure then when Thursday rolled around and you've kind of nailed it and there's no your parents just eyeballing you the whole time.
Because my mum was absolutely terrified and I got like forearmed off the... like right in front of her, and she was not best pleased.
She just getting flashbacks to trying to drag you away from the living room window.
Yeah,
just going 100%. No.
Yep, not happening.
so you had those matches, and like I say, you're now in. You've had your few matches. How did you go from that? In my notes here to April, appearing on the WWE Network. For ICW, unless I've missed something in between here, which no. So you went from three matches on a showcase show to then being against, and I cannot say her name, Tonga. It's fine. I thought maybe a wee fancy way of saying it, but no, Tonga, that's how it's spelled. How'd you go from that to then WWE Network, ICW Fight Club?
Crazy, isn't it?
Yeah, a bit wild, pardon the pun. Depending on who put you forward for it.
I think you might have a good guess.
So how was that?
Unbelievable. I think the coolest moment of my life. It was more than... Because I think like the showcase was obviously a debut in front of a crowd, but it wasn't necessarily like a debut type thing. So it was still kind of like waiting on that and still working really hard towards that. And for it to be ICW was just something that I could like, so I still can't believe that it happened. I kind of have no words for it because it was just such an unbelievable experience. Such a great opportunity. And I loved every minute of it.
So, I mean, I've asked them, number of people now about this, but it must be so weird that you can go and just search your name on www.com or WWE Network and then a match pops up and it's like, this is just mind-blowing. How many people did you show as soon as it happened? Because I'm assuming you kind of kept it secret until the episode aired itself. But how many people did you go, like, I'm on the WWE Network?
Just... Quite a lot, yeah. Well, I mean, I shared it like on my personal kind of pages as well, and it kind of blew up a little bit with people that I know in the States and things like that. Like, people were just super excited. I think people had been, I think on my personal page, I'd been kind of sharing my journey from the beginning, and I think people could see how much it meant to me and how hard I'd been working. So I think when it got to that, people were just super happy for me and super excited. And it was just a really cool moment. It was such a cool weekend because I debuted for Pro 2 the weekend that it went up as well. So I kind of had Saturday and Sunday. And it was just, in terms of thinking about something for so long and thinking about a moment for so long and wanting it so badly and wanting it to go well as well, I think I couldn't have dreamed that weekend any better than real life. So like, I'm, you know, super blessed to have had that experience, and definitely a lot more confident now that I've went and done it.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Going in when you're talking about your confidence, I don't know how much you balance yourself and Daisy when you go into the ring, whether it's you try and it's all her, so you can kind of shield your own confidence. Because I again know that from my own experience, and when I do this, I sound like the most confident person in the world. If you meet me at the show, I am the most quietest person you'll ever meet. I'm the most awkward person I'll ever meet. But here, I look like I enjoy speaking to people in general.
Yeah, but definitely.
In real life, I have one of those faces that just says, no, not today. Leave me alone, please. So don't. If anyone hears this and goes, he was right rude at a show I went to. It's my face. I can't help it. It's just the way it sits. So confidence going into it. So you had your three showcase matches against friends and family and all that kind of stuff. And then you go into an ICW crowd, which it's not as, I don't think it's as raucous as it was, as it's previously, its reputation preceded it. But it's still a quite tough crowd because most of the ones that are there, they'll be the hardcore generally. So they'll either know a little bit of anything or everything about all sorts of wrestling. Yeah. Or they're just there to see ICW. So did you feel that you got the crowd doing what you wanted them to do? I suppose in that case it was really Taonga who was getting showcased in the match itself. But the bits and pieces I saw of it, because I did watch it because I do watch Fight Club for the results. But you didn't. I can't believe that was your fourth match. There's no question. There's just me rambling now at this point. But no, how did you find going into front of an ICW crowd with that reputation? And did you feel that you did as well as you hoped to do in that match?
Oh, I've done so much better. And if you could have seen what I was like before I went on. I mean, and it was a very last minute thing as well. So I think I found out maybe like really late Thursday, and then it was that Sunday. So there wasn't really much time for me to be nervous, because I was super nervous like coming up to Pro 2, and I knew about Pro 2 for maybe about, you know, 12 weeks or something like that. So like, you know, in training I was just working so hard towards that, and then like I'd had an injury as well, so I was like super worried about that, and I like, you know, would I be ready, you know, just worrying about every single little thing basically. And I didn't have time to. I really didn't have time to. It was that thing where it's like it's happening. You know, you've got to go out and just do it. And you know, like what a great opportunity to have. You know, like you can't. If I was to be nervous in that moment, I would have done myself a disservice because you only get that moment once. So I, you know, and it was great because Andy was there. So you know, we talked through everything, and you know, like he was super confident in me, so that gave me confidence, you know what I mean? Like he wouldn't have kind of put me forward for something if he didn't believe that I was ready for it and that would do a good job. So it was really great to have him there, and you know, like he was like the first person that I saw when I walked back through, and he gave me like feedback and stuff like that. So it was just like a super, yeah, the whole experience was just incredible. And then watching it back, I can't quite believe that it's me, but yeah, it was a dream come true, honestly. I can't really say much more than that.
Are you one of those people that, like, if you're like for the Pro 2 thing, you're told weeks ahead, so you've probably Googled how to get to the venue far too many times? Yeah, that's fine.
It's like, Andy, you are going to take me, right? Like, you are driving. Yeah.
You still check up anyway. Just make sure if he goes down a different road, you're going, whoa, 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 what's happening here?
Yeah, that's not what Google Maps said.
Google Maps says you need to go this way. Yeah, I mean, I'm still like that now. I go to shows in Aberdeen pretty as regular as I could, and even then I still had to double check how to get to the venue.
Yeah, and you knew exactly where you were going.
That's it, yeah, because I drove there. Usually it's my wife that drives because she gets travel sick, so it's her that drives, which I'm happy with because I hate driving in Aberdeen. But I had to go to the show last week myself because she's went to Inverness to buy baby stuff, you know, and I was like, right, I can do this easy. I got lost once, but somehow my internal sat nav found the venue without checking. I was like, oh my god, I've done this.
Excellent.
I was 3 hours early, but I've done this.
That's brilliant.
So I had to go find another place. I think I knew where it was, and I found it. I was like, this is the best day ever. I haven't even seen wrestling yet. This is the best day ever.
It's a good start to the day, isn't it?
Exactly. Cars in one piece. I haven't had a meltdown, you know. Let's go to Smith's and look at the pops. So you had your ICW in Pro 2, of course. We do have a question from Logan Storm about Pro 2, which I'll get to in a second. But so you're against Ashley Vega. So Ashley probably would have come across when they were doing the FPWA, were doing all female classes.
Yeah.
Imagine. And of course, Ashley, I think she did a couple one-to-ones and a couple stuff there as well. So I was actually a opponent that you were kind of familiar with outside of the ring before that match.
Yeah, very familiar.
So again, she came in. It's weird. It's like when you describe your character being like the 80s throw, 80s, 90s throwback, and then Ashley's is the 2000s.
It's brilliant, isn't it? I mean, what more of a story could you want?
It's a very easy one to tell, isn't it? It's just perfect. So yeah, how did you find the match at Pro 2?
Oh, it was amazing. Again, just for it being, you know, it was different to the ICW, like very different. And the crowd are different. I got to do my entrance for the first time, which was just incredible. I loved every second of it. I had some friends and family there, and there was just like so many kids who were just having a ball. It was just brilliant. The crowd were amazing. And in terms of the match itself, like I think from what you described, like it is such, we have such a good story to tell. Like it's so obvious who's the babyface and who's the heel. You know, it's just so obvious. And I think we're such different styles as well that putting the two of them together, like we do have a great match. And I think we did have a really great match that day. And again, it was just such a cool experience. I loved every minute of it.
If it hasn't already popped up on their Pro Tuesday, I'm definitely going to have to check it
out.
Yeah,
just because of
that vibe, that 80s, 90s versus 2000s, it just, it's just something, it's so obvious. And if you don't, it could be a story you could tell in any promotion with very little build-up.
Yeah, super proud of it. Yeah, I think it'll be up soon, hopefully, so more people will get to see it.
Fingers crossed. So we do have a question from Logan. Like I said, he said, did you enjoy your time at Pro 2 and will we be seeing you back?
Absolutely. I loved every minute of it. I'd love to come back.
Excellent. Nice and easy.
Nice and easy.
Last thing I've got wrestling-wise, as in your actual wrestling, is the match that's upcoming. At this point, when this goes out, it would have happened. But I don't know if you've ever seen a Govan show online, so that's what I'm going to ask about. Community Pro Wrestling debuting against LA Armstrong and Harmony Sky. It's 25th of May. Which, you know, useless information to anyone watching now because it's happened.
It would have happened already.
So Harmony, of course, you got experience with because you've had your first three matches with her, who I've heard nothing but good things about. Thankfully, I've had a couple of chats with her through this podcast now. And
she's great, isn't she?
It's weird seeing, because when we first spoke to her, she never had a match.
Yeah.
And then when I spoke to her the second time, I don't know who I was speaking to because it wasn't the girl I was speaking to in the first interview. It was just ridiculous, the confidence that she'd grown in that time. What do you know about Govan and Community Pro Wrestling in general when you come into that show?
I was at the last show.
Before.
And it was amazing. It was so good. I enjoyed every minute of it. The crowd were amazing. Like nothing like anything that I'd ever seen before. So I'm super excited to give that a go because that's just going to be a hoot from start to finish.
Yeah, it's a wild one. Just from watching it on YouTube, it's a crowd where I'm like, oh, I wouldn't want to come in with an insecurity because they'll find it.
Yeah, I think the kids are brilliant though.
They
just absolutely love it. It's exactly what you want, you know. That's exactly what you want. You'll find out whether they like you or not from the beginning, and you'll be able to, you know, switch things up if you need to.
Yeah, I think there was a match because Fair City Saints against More Than Hype, and Fair City Saints came out in orange, and I don't think they realised how much they would get booed when they came out. They got booed a lot when they came out because they're all in orange, and of course it's Glasgow area, and I don't know whether to begin understanding all that kind of thing. But geez, they had a rough night, and of course it goes without saying other people have had really rough nights in Govan, but. It's loud. It's expressive. They don't jump the tables. That's kind of all you want from that point. As long as they don't come to hit you, then don't worry about the rest. Right. So yeah, that's kind of where we're at with your actual in-ring stuff. I noticed that you do like to travel for your training. So I was noticing that you've ended up in Cardiff. Training with Wild Boar. Is that another just destiny thing? You were down there and happened to go along?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like the story of my life at this point. The universe is just giving me such great opportunities and I'm taking full advantage. But yeah, down working in Bristol, so it's only like 45, 50 minutes, which is what I drive every day to go to training here anyway. So we just kind of messaged them and asked. They've kind of got an option where you can pay per class. So we messaged them and they were more than happy for me to come down, and it was like such a cool experience. I've been twice now, and both sessions were just brilliant. So like not too much different to Andy's style of coaching, but still different enough that like I'm picking up on, you know, things that potentially I haven't thought of before, or like trying different things. And obviously like working with different people and getting to meet loads of different people has just been, yeah, it's just been brilliant. And I'm looking forward to being back. I'll probably be going back a few times over the next few months, so I'm looking forward to that.
I suppose that with Wild Boar being there, and Andy of course both wrestling at NXT UK fairly regularly, that they do have all those bits of training, but yeah, like you say, add their own little bits and pieces in there. You know, you also end up at Top Rope Wrestling Academy as well, which with the Sheik himself.
Yeah.
So again, just by luck, they were just in the right place, right time, or was that a bit more of a concentrated
one? Yeah, I think it was more of an organized thing between Andy and Sheik after their matches at ICW. They had that three matches kind of thing that they had going on for a while. And I think it was just an opportunity to, again, get to train somewhere different and get to meet people and train with different people. So five of us went down there, and then I think five of them came up the week that I was at New Wave, actually. So I didn't get to see them at FPW, but I heard that it was a great session again. So that was really cool, because again, it's just, you know, completely different. You know, you're in a different ring, you're in a different environment. So in terms of, you know, talking about that confidence and having to have the confidence to go out and do these things, like I'm really kind of taking advantage of anything that kind of pushes me outside of my comfort zone, because you're going to be in that position regardless of, you know, what route you take. You're always going to be new somewhere. So kind of getting used to that.
And it also helps with, of course, the confidence thing. I mean, it's great being Daisy Jenkins all the time, but I suppose when you're traveling to different places to train, like you're saying, you're brand new every time you go there, or the first time you go there anyway. So you've got to kind of be yourself for at least the first little bit before you can snap into wrestler mode. Right, so let's kind of lift the wrestling talk for a moment, because I've got a bunch of really off-topic questions that we can go with. Through Instagram and the like. So Stone Malone, we'll start with that one. He's just asked, favourite McFlurry? Nice and easy.
What a good question. Well, is it an easy question though? I think I really like the seasonal ones. You know, whenever they put on like a cream egg, like you always have to get the cream egg one. So I'm going to go for that because I get one without fail.
Yep, so it sounds like you and my wife at the same time. I'm a Smarties guy. I'm classic. I like it. Keep it simple.
I do like a Smarties one. You know, like the classics.
I like it. Colors the. I love Cocoa Pops because it makes. I'm a child at heart. It makes the milk go chocolatey. I like Smarties one because it makes ice cream go like different colors.
Yeah.
But like I said, right at the start of this interview, I'm a very simple man, very simple taste. We've got Ian Skinner asking best character in Mortal Kombat.
Oh, I never played Mortal Kombat.
Oh, I thought you had, because I have no help to you in this.
I don't know who I would pick, because I played Street Fighter, so
okay.
I don't think he's going to be upset with that or not. I'm sure I'll find out.
All right, but favorite character best character in Street Fighter?
I always went Blanka, because I just would constantly electrocute people. It was it was just the only way to win at that point.
Fair enough.
I had no skill to it. It was just that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, any games like that, it's just I hit all the buttons. I didn't know what combos were. You just kind of hope for the best. If you hit a fatality or whatever they call it, I'm like, oh, cool. I don't know how I did that.
You don't even need to look. You just need to press the buttons.
Exactly. Right. So what else we got? It's office wrestling. So much wrestling. Right. Okay. Right. I'll do my ones then. Silly questions that we ask everyone. First off, what's your favorite dinosaur?
A pterodactyl.
Nice. Right. Nice and simple. What would win a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Oh, that's hard. I'm going to go for the cow.
Fair. That's if you just go with your heart, that's fine. Another thing, well, it's not really part of our usual silly questions, because it's not really a silly question. Because I was noticing when I was doing my research, basically I stalked her Instagram for a little bit for some inspiration, and I noticed she had a Deathly Hallows tattoo.
I do.
Which is, again, right into, well, not so much my wheelhouse, but I've been subjected to all the Harry Potter films in life. Oh, Christ, microphone fell. That's a spell and a half. That's been cursed. Right. So yeah. What was it about Harry Potter? Was it just? I suppose we're the right age for that one when it came out. 97.
Yeah. It was when it first came out, wasn't it? And I think we were the same age.
Mm-hmm.
So it was that, and also when I mentioned that I worked in retail, it was Waterstones. So I used to be a bookshop manager. So it was very much of the time of my life, shall we say. It's just kind of, yeah, it's always been a part of it.
So have you ever done the Potter world? Have you ever done what house you're in?
Yeah, all of that stuff. I'm in Gryffindor, obviously.
Gryffindor, as you can see by my organisation skills, of course I'm a Hufflepuff. I always wanted to be a Gryffindor. I've got a Gryffindor hoodie and everything. I wanted to be that, but it's Hufflepuff. It's very much obviously
that's
that.
That's such a Hufflepuff thing to do, though, isn't it?
I know. Just hope for the best. Going, I like red. Wear this.
Yeah, at least you're on brand.
Yeah. Have you done Harry Potter? We've done the Harry Potter world as well, London and all that kind of stuff.
I've not done the one in London, but I've been to Orlando like three or four times.
The cooler one.
Yeah. I don't know, the London one looks pretty cool, but I actually got picked to do, there's a wand experience in the Diagon Alley in Orlando. So it's in the Ollivanders, and essentially like I think it's maybe like a group of like 20 people, and you go into a room and one person gets picked to do the whole like wand thing. And it was just one of the coolest things I've ever done, because you get to the point where like you choose your wand and then it does the like thing like it does in the movie, and there's like, you know, wind and everything. But then, you know, you're kind of like, oh, well, you're just wanting me to spend $75 on this wand because you've said that it's mine, and obviously I'm going to do it because that's why I'm here. Very expensive, but a cool experience nonetheless.
I'm not a huge fan of it. I've grown to love it because my wife's obsessed with it. She's a little bit older. She was about 11 when it came out, so bang on the age of Harry Potter. She's just grown up with it. Seeing her face going to Harry Potter in London was just the best thing ever.
Oh, that's good.
Going out, because I would walk in front, because she gets overwhelmed when it's like something really amazing. This is our first time going, and I saw the big Hogwarts Express. So obviously I took my camera out and recorded their reaction watching it.
Oh, yeah. That's brilliant.
Oh yeah, it's not allowed to go anywhere because
floods of tears.
But even at the end, I won't spoil the ending because you may go one day and you'll see it for yourself. But it's just something. Even I had a wee tear in my eye watching it. Oh. It was just incredible to go. But
I've not actually heard that much about it other than it's really good. So.
It's a lot of fun, but yeah, it's a whole wrestling mentality as well, because they had a bit where you stand and you go up and a broom starts levitating, and it's very obvious a guy that's just next to you hitting a button. But in that moment when you go up and it goes up when you say it, it's like, oh my god, I'm a wizard. It's amazing. Then you go, oh, it's a guy there, but still, I made it. As soon as I saw the Death Hallows, I was like, I'll definitely ask you some Harry Potter stuff, because I think I like finding out a little bit something different when I'm speaking, doing these interviews, and if I can latch on, it's usually Marvel stuff, but if I can find something different, I think people listening kind of appreciate me not speaking about Marvel as much as I can.
Well, I've also got a Guardians of the Galaxy tattoo, so.
Oh, nice. Is it like a cassette or anything in particular?
Cassette tape, yep.
I got one recently that's kind of,
oh, nice.
Because I had a space there and I really wanted something in there. I was like, I'm going to keep it. I realized that's useless to the audio listeners. It says we are Groot for those that are curious. She goes, look at this. Everyone listening going, what? I can't see this. Anyway, right. So I've got more wrestling questions. I'm trying to cross them because some people ask the same questions twice. Okay. Some have asked the same thing, so we'll see where we go with this. Eddie Castle asking, top five lucha arm drag slash moves.
Is that because my main moves are arm drags? I think people have got that. I don't know. I don't know if I could say five. Well, obviously my 619 arm drag, which I've now named the slingshot, that would be my favourite. 619, I'd have to go for that. Anything from the top rope. And I'm going to hope that one day I will be going on to the top rope. We're getting there. But I would have to go for that.
We've got a couple about dream opponents, which we'll get to. Let's see. Craig Berry, he's asked a couple, so I'll pick one of them and we'll kind of dot back and forth. If you had to pick a tag team partner, who would it be and why would it be him?
This is something that Craig does every training session. Whoever he's standing next to is his tag team partner. And it makes everybody else jealous because we've all been his tag team partner at one point in that training session. And he just keeps switching it up. So I think that's maybe a reason why it wouldn't be him. Because I couldn't trust that he would stick around.
I'm so glad you said something else because my brain said something. I thought, can't say that out loud. I'll say it. I don't care. It's my own podcast. It's a bit of a tag team slag, isn't he? He's just
yeah. Well,
It's not a PC word for it now, but you know, he's a key for all sorts of locks, right? again, Dudes at Ringside podcast. Where in the world have you thought of wrestling besides Scotland?
Oh, I'd wrestle anywhere.
With your friends in the US, is there any? Do they kind of give you some local indies that they will go, oh, check these guys out. We want to wrestle there. Put your CV in.
I'm not sure that I think they just like that I do it. I'm not sure. There are a couple of people who are wrestling fans, so maybe once it gets to that point, I think it would be cool to wrestle in Maryland because that is where I kind of used to live. So I suppose that would be like a really cool full circle moment. So awesome. If there was anything in DC or Baltimore, that would be pretty cool.
I'm sure there is. There's so much wrestling everywhere.
Yeah, whether I can get there, we'll see.
I'm sure it'll be fine. Right. Okay. Well, so we got. Right. I've got a bit. It's not so much a question. It's more of just a statement. It just says, it's Lachlan 066. He just asked, I'm autistic. I want to become a wrestler one day. So I suppose wrestling, autism is really not a holdback, depending on the level of it, I suppose, of autism. But how can I word this into a question? How do you find wrestling is? Do you find wrestling is easily accessible when it comes to FPWA as an environment?
100%. Everybody's welcome. You know, there's so much, and it's such a supportive atmosphere that there's always going to be someone who if somebody needs some extra help with something or whatever, everybody works with each other as well, so like, you know, you'd never kind of be on your own too, you know. It's quite, I mean, I suppose it's not really small classes. There can be between like 10 and 15 of us there. It's just a small unit, but no, everybody's welcome.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's best just to, I like that between yourselves, and I like sort of Renegade are all about big inclusivity kind of thing as well. It seems to be, it's less restrictive now, wrestling, I suppose, because because it was a bit more inclusive then, but back in the oldie days, I suppose when Andy started, would be more accurate, it was more closed off wrestling. You had to kind of go through a whole initiation thing to be allowed to learn how to do it safely. Yeah. You're more a case of getting hazed for first little bit. No, I don't know if that's Andy's story, but it seemed a bit more closed off, but nowadays it's like, try it. If it's not for you, will I find you a role that you can do?
Yeah.
Or that's, you can just go back behind the barrier and just watch it.
There's so much to wrestling other than the wrestlers themselves. You know, it wouldn't be a show if you didn't have everybody behind the scenes and even the fans. So, you know, there is a space for everybody, you know, regardless of what it is. But I think from my experience, if you've ever wanted to give it a go, just go for it. Like, you know, you'll quickly realize if it's for you or not. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and then it's okay if it's not, because there's still a space for you. But I think, I mean, I'm incredibly lucky. I feel incredibly lucky to be at FPW because of the kind of how I've got into it. I think, like, it's been the best place for me. Not that I know what, you know, I've been to other places and they've been great too. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, personally, it's been the best place for me. So if anybody's in the area and wants to give it a go, you're more than welcome to come join us.
There you go. There's an advertisement for you. Right, so we've got a couple about, Gaz Williams, he's asked quite a similar question about Dream Tag Team partners. Of course, we know Craig's not on that list.
he's going to be so mad at me.
It's all right. Our first interview, we went through a good 5 minutes of me thinking of other names for him because of Berry, and he can come out in all red gear and he'd be Strawberry. And it wasn't my finest hour for the first couple podcasts when I was just going, Berry, let's just make loads of puns about it. So Craig's asked Dream opponents and Gaz asked Dream opponents and Dream Tag Team partners. So we'll go with Gaz's question to amalgamate it. So who'd be your Dream opponent and who would be your Dream Tag Team partner?
I think I would have to say Becky Lynch would be my Dream opponent. Just, again, that sort of like full circle thing. She's the one that really inspired me the most. So it would kind of come down to that. That would be my dream. Whether that's possible or not, we'll never know until it gets to it potentially, but that would be my dream. Other dream opponents, I suppose, like, it's kind of cool to think about like past. So obviously Sherry, I would have loved to have wrestled Alundra Blaze. Just another one that I look up to a lot. In terms of tag team partners, maybe a little bit like out there, but I think my dream tag team partner would be Ember Moon, who's now Athena, I want to say.
I think so, yeah.
That was just there. Technically, she's just unbelievable. And she's everything that I could ever dream of being. And Mustafa Ali as well, if that was a possibility. Yes, please.
Very nice choices. Very, very nice. Right, so what else we've got here? We've got, I think that's everything off the old Instagram, I think. Combat did that, training. How long did that? We've just about answered Zach Swift's question of if you could wrestle anyone past or present, who would it be? We kind of answered that, but I've got another question at the end that'll kind of full circle that one. How'd you get wrestled? Done that. Go. So I think the last question I've got on the Instagram is from Nicole Jasmine. Just simply says, let's wrestle soon.
Yes, 100%.
So for those that are unaware, because I haven't announced, or would have announced it at this point, we're due to have Nicole on the podcast.
Oh, brilliant.
This season. So I'm quite excited for it, because by that point she would have had her first match. And
yes.
I've heard so much support for her. I know there's a story there. There's going to be a story for us.
That'll be a great chat.
And the last one we've got from Craig, again, long-time listener, every-time writer. Anywhere you definitely want to wrestle, promotions or venues?
Oh, that's a good question. I think it goes without saying that I'd love to go back to ICW. Same with Pro 2, love to go back. I think Discovery would be amazing. And there's loads of other places in Scotland as well that would just be incredible. Like, there's so much going on right now and so many good people. And kind of, you know, as I get a little bit more experience, it would be cool to kind of branch out and potentially go down south too. Maybe, you know, wrestle some of the people that I've met in Cardiff at one point. That would be pretty cool. The more that I get to know them, that would be pretty sweet. And then Eve, maybe.
Of course, yeah.
That would be a good one.
That'd probably be in terms of a place you can go, it's just always wrestling. How much you can learn from that particular 100%. Brand would be incredible. Right, so I think I've ticked off everything on my notes as well. So before we wrap up, I don't think we've missed out anything glaring in your wrestling journey, unless there's something popped in your head going, why isn't you asking me about this? But I think we covered everything. Am I right in thinking?
So.
Excellent.
I think so.
That's fine. I like to have a thorough podcast, even though I'm a half a puff.
Everything that we've got to talk about to this point. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, as soon as we hit stop record, I'll be like, oh, shit, I could have asked you about this. But, you know,
yeah.
This means it's open for a part two if the podcast returns. So, yeah. You know, always got to keep that open. So last question we ask people is, it's a fantasy booking question. So Vince McMahon's phoned you up and said, right, Daisy, I love the Daisy chain. Mm-hmm. We're going to market it everywhere. We're going to sell all the merch, but we're going to put you in the main event at WrestleMania. You're in charge. You get to pick the match stipulation. You get to pick your opponent or opponents. So anyone. The only stipulation is to have to be alive. Who would it be? What would the match be?
Would it just be me and Becky? Probably. What? Seems a bit like of a boring answer, though, but it is just that full circle thing.
I mean, I'll tell you some past answers. We've had London Lovelust, who booked a Royal Rumble for the main event, and they would enter number one, and then they would just pick 29 other people to be their opponents, so they got to wrestle all of them. Excellent answer. But nobody. I've asked this question about 25 times now. Nobody said Kenno from Hell, and I'm still forever disappointed. I don't know. Did you remember Kenno from Hell? Just out of curiosity.
I think so. I mean, like the other thing that like popped into my head was all of the like crazy matches, you know, like the casket matches and all the rest of it. Like, imagine having one of them. But I don't think that would terrify me.
No. Well, Kenno from Hell. For anyone wondering who's listening to this, they're not of my vintage. It was a Hell in a Cell, steel bar, steel cage in the middle, right around the ring. Hell in a Cell around it, and then around the ring was dogs. And it was Al Snow versus Big Boss Man. Al Snow versus Big Boss Man. It didn't.
Oh, I loved Al Snow as well. I'm gonna have to go and watch that.
It didn't happen again because the dogs were not that violent. They were.
Were they just like sitting waiting?
Oh, they were not sitting. They were they were busy doing other things.
That's excellent.
I love
that's it. Gonna be what I watch. Like as soon as I get.
I like. The last couple of episodes, I like just giving out random things. Leo McLean's still a top episode because he gave me the cow versus sheep answer through YouTube. But we spoke about Pat Patterson, Gerald Briscoe, King of the Ring 99 for far too long.
Yeah.
it was too far by the time because I kept coming back to it because it was just, it's so incredibly, it's probably offensive nowadays, actually, when you come think of it. It's of its time. Anyway, right. So, yeah, you, Becky Lynch, getting back to that. That would just straight up main event. Doesn't need a stipulation.
I mean, I feel like there's maybe a better answer in there.
It's your fancy booking. So that's your choice.
Yeah, I think that's it. I would maybe want to go, like, potentially, like, me and Bailey against Becky and Sasha. Or, like, I would want to go against Becky. I wouldn't want to tag them.
And to bring Zach's question back in, just alive or dead. So who would be the dream opponent that you could regenerate and they would be back to their prime? I was thinking Sherry would probably be my answer, but really? Yeah. Anyone else comes to mind?
I mean, China would have been amazing. Bill Nakano.
Oh, yeah.
Just like, you know, storytellers, that's the thing. Just like anyone with a great story. And the thing is that me against those people would be a great story. It's really what I was thinking there.
I'll throw in just out of all that Ivory as well, seeing she's part of the original Glow. I think that would be quite a cool thing to mash together. Right, I think that's enough of your time I've taken up this evening.
Oh.
Like I say, open for a part two hopefully when if this podcast returns and you've got like belts and all that kind of stuff.
One can only hope.
You never know. So where can people find out more about Daisy Jenkins on the social media?
At the moment I'm just on Instagram, so it's daisy.jenkins_fpwa.
Nice and straightforward. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me.
Thank you.
I've had a blast and I can't wait for other people to hear this.
Oh, me too.